Good evening, everybody. I welcome you to a webinar made by or arranged by European Federation of Geologists. My name is Markku Iljiina, and I will use a couple of the first minutes to tell you a few words about the panel of experts which are working under the European Federation of Geologists. Which has around 10 various panel of experts, one of them being for minerals, panel of experts of minerals, and I'm the coordinator of that panel. These panels are actually contributing to development of European policies, and they produce various position papers, advisory documents, and they are distributed to various DG persons in European Commission and also the European Parliament. So panel of experts of minerals, we work as an EFG body of experts to support the raw materials supply group of European Commission. And we support and work closely with the Pan-European Reserves and Resources Reporting Committee. And quite recently, we are in the ERMA, which is European Raw Materials Alliance. We work there under the flag of European Federation of Geologists. So if any one of you is interested to join in this panel, please contact EFG, and they will channel your interest to me, and I will then contact you, and we will work out how to join in into this very interesting panel of experts. Our presenter today will be Mentor Demi from Kosovo. He has worked several years, more than 10 years, in various junior companies, mainly in Western Tethyan Belt. And quite recently, he established a UK-based company called Western Tethyan Resources. And he's focusing now into copper gold exploration in that area. And the title of his presentation will be Prospect Generator Business Model. So I'm very much looking forward to this presentation, and I will now give the floor to Mentor Demi. Please go ahead.
As Markku said, I've worked for most of my career in the Western Tethyan Belt, so between Armenia, Georgia to the Balkans, and being very lucky to work with some of the most interesting juniors with Lithium International and their gold discovery in Armenia, a project that we brought from a discovery to a development. So because the project has gone into a mining stage, I wanted to stay on my exploration side of the business. So I have started several juniors working in Kosovo and the Western Tethyan Belt, with the Western Tethyan Resources as one of the most recent companies. One of the reasons we want to talk about this topic is because of the importance of the metals we need. But there are not many places that we can really go and explore for metals. If we look at this map here, so we have just some, as a black line, just some of the most interesting parts of the known belts where we basically can go and look for more metals. Why we look for more metals? Because we have a deficit between what we produce every year and between what we basically find. chart here, in the last 30 years, you see that the number of the discoveries has basically dropped. Compared to the gold price, that has really gone up. So the number of discoveries has gone quite a vertical. So if you see last couple of years, we have even zeroed the number of discoveries between the more than 2 million ounces. Why is important this graph, and why I'm talking about gold, is because it's one of the most important metals, but also we are mining about 90 million ounces of gold per year, but we are only finding about 40 million. Basically, just go into a little bit of details what we basically call a prospect today. It's an outcropping mineralization, an old mine, an area selected based on some sort of geological or geomorphological tools and stuff. For example, this Gosan rich in gold is from one of our prospects in Kosovo, which was presented as a manganese rich structure in the old Yugoslav data, but basically because they didn't look for gold in that area, so we found that this Gosan actually runs about 2 grams gold in it. So this is kind of a prospect in the areas that although have been explored previously, it still represents a potential exploration target. So generating prospects, there are several ways we usually do. It's the traditional way or prospecting. It's also known as the boots in the ground technique. It's more today's prospecting that's based a lot on technology. And then we also have a future prospecting, which is probably going to be based entirely in energy. This is a picture of a Dutch geologist and his group that basically was going for climbing in Papua New Guinea. And basically they discovered one of the biggest gold and copper mine in the world in the mid 30s and still active, just to show that centuries ago, you could still walk over world-class type alteration and mineral deposits. So we have here, for example, in the 19th century, you could do that. You could still do that in the 20th century, and you have some big mineral deposits that have been discovered using the traditional boots in the ground technique. So we were talking here about the Red Dog, about the Trogera Erzberg, which is the West Papua discovery that we are showing here in the picture. But today's prospecting, it still uses the kind of traditional way, because there are still ways and places where you could go by boots in the ground technique and get new discoveries. But most of the prospecting basically comes using advanced geophysical and geochemistry tools, using different concept, basically geopolitical changes in the regions, like, for example, countries that have been running the government on a communist style for a very long time, and they want to come to a different capitalist kind of country. So basically there are a lot of places where you can find this government changes and geopolitical shift as a very good target. And basically you can use all kind of comparison between a different deposits in order to generate a prospect. So I'm going to talk here just a little bit about why is important to use the technology, the updated technology on the exploration, because we have some very good cases here in Balkans. you can see here in the picture in the right. So this is the geology cross-section of one of the best discoveries in the last 15 years in the world, and it's made in Serbia. So a few kilometers adjacent to an old mine. So basically using different, most up-to-date technology tools. Basically, a Canadian company discovered a blind deposit, which was sitting about 400 meters below the surface. We have another case, for example, in Balkans as well. For example, in Kosovo, although we have a very good historical database that was generated during the Yugoslav time, most of the focus during the 60s and 70s was for base metals, and no one really looked for gold. So in the areas adjacent to an old lead zinc mine in Kosovo, a Canadian group, Avrupa Minerals, went and discovered a high-grade gold deposit, Slivova. Why is important to look at the geopolitical changes as prospecting areas is because countries has also created a good databases in order to attract investments and to delineate potential structures. For example, in Kosovo, with the help of the Geological Society of London and Finnish Geological Association, the entire Kosovo was covered with airborne geophysics for three methods, which really helped the country to generate targets and new structures and prospects basically for companies to come and explore. Amongst this, they also did the stream sediment sampling covering entire Kosovo, which is also a good tool. So today's prospecting is good in these areas because you also have a good database in the countries, but also because countries have not been explored for a long time and using proper methods, you can still go in these areas and discover something that has not been known before. So as we said earlier, a lot of the prospecting today is based on technology and looking for blind deposits. So we definitely need luck during the exploration phase, but we have to put proper geological and exploration thoughts into prospective areas in order to find something that probably is hidden hundreds of meters below surface. We mentioned just a little bit earlier that we also have to look about the future prospecting, which is going to probably based a lot on development of technologies. So whilst there are some thoughts that probably we should start looking at other planets, there are still a lot of prospects in the Earth, but that is most probably going to come from deep sea mining. We know that there are a lot of resources underneath the oceans, but we just have to make a better job in order to start exploring them cheaply. And also we should work, or countries should work together in order to define all the environmental regulations and all the mitigation strategies basically in order to limit the damage to the sea life basically. So I quickly run through just some of the prospecting types we have done and we are doing in the world. I now want to go into the importance of why prospect can be a model and what are his benefits and the difficulties. So A prospect generator is a junior exploration company, basically, but employs just a little bit a different approach to the exploration. Whilst a traditional junior would try to take a project or acquire it and explore it in details until a BFS phase, bankable feasibility study, and then try to sell or build themselves, a prospect generator would try to stake, acquire a specific ground that has some significant mineral potential, and then basically as early as possible try to partner it with another group, a usually bigger group, in order to explore the project into more details. So if we look one-to-one, a traditional junior versus a prospect generator, this is one of the best graphs that basically shows this. Whilst a traditional junior would try to take a project or two and put all its effort into these projects, a project generator would try to generate multiple projects and then basically option them to a different group or to a single bigger group. So if you look into financing, for example, a traditional junior usually would do financings through equity, whilst a project generator has multiple tools that can really do this through equity, partnering, through royalties, and et cetera. What are the benefits basically here is that traditional junior has very high risk of moving a project all the way through to production, whilst a project generator, first to discover and then put to production, whilst a project generator would basically split the risk by having interest in multiple projects, therefore have the project, therefore have the potential to have multiple discoveries on their hand. Of course, they would own not 100% these projects, but they would rather have 30% in multiple discoveries than risking 100% in one single discovery. So why prospect generator is very attractive model, at least for the institutional investors, is their share structure. So whilst the traditional junior would try to go continuously into the market and raise money and dilute the shareholders to explore a project or two, a project generator would finance just a little bit in the market and then basically uses someone else's money to explore the project. So a recap of how the project generator basically works is this. You have three main phases. Exploration is just the basic, basically, after the project acquisition, just the basic exploration, and then try to partner it immediately to a better or a bigger company that can finance the development of the project. Several ways that the project generator can benefit is by selling the asset, by spinning out assets, share price appreciation. This is a question mark because as much as the companies grow by share price appreciation, they also do get a lot of depreciation in the share price. So we're going to talk about that later. And also one of the most common method that basically is becoming now is a prospect generator basically selling their interest in the projects for a royalty, for NSR. So this is becoming a business model on its own. One of the famous graphs explaining the life cycle of a mineral project from discovery to a production is a graph of a mining legend, Pierre Lassonde, and which I'm presenting here with a little bit of modification, basically to show what are the risks of moving a project from the concept to a production. So if you look at this black line, it shows the road of the traditional junior, basically, which will develop the concept of a project, drill it to resources, then do all the heavy studies like PEA and PFS, and basically try to build a mine or sell to someone. But the road is very risky, especially the geopolitical risk. If you can see here the geopolitical section, basically you do not have too much risk developing the concept in the beginning, but as the project develops, so does increases the geopolitical risk. And I've been part of the projects, and especially one in Armenia, and we went all the way through this cycle with a project. Basically, we discovered, we explored, we financed, we started to build a mine, and then the project basically, and the company, the country went into war with a neighboring country, and now it has postponed it everything. So basically taking a project all the way through is very risky because it's a long time. It's usually 15 to 20 years of a process, and it is very difficult. So that's why a project generator, a prospect generator is attractive, because it will only try to benefit from the most attractive side of the business, and also try to cash it as early as possible. So you can see this yellow to red line here. It basically shows the way of the project generator cycle. So it will develop the concept in 2-3 years with find a partner to JV. And then in case of a discovery, so basically the value of the project increases, and they would try to sell when it comes to the resource development. After a resource estimation, we'll try to sell it for cash or NSR, etc. So just because we talked about two different, not different approaches, but two ways of doing a business in the mineral industry, let's just have a look at few successful juniors, and also let's have a look at few prospect generators that has done this in the best way. So this is a project, a Canadian company in Serbia. They came early 2000s and they acquired a project called Čukaru Peki. They developed this project, did the early heavy liftings basically in the project to a PEA phase. And after 7 or 8 years, they sold it to another Canadian exploration company, Nevsun, for $440 million. Nevsun took this project, developed it a little bit further to a pre-feasibility study, and after 2 years, they sold the project to a Chinese mining giant, Zijin Mining, for $1.8 billion. So Zijin took the project, developed it a little bit further. Now it has gone into an agreement with a close by mining facilities, which are state-owned, the Bor complex, where they're basically going to invest about $1 billion in the facility as well. So basically a project that went from early stage exploration in less than 15 years, basically it become a multi-billion dollar project. So this is a very successful traditional junior model changed twice their ownership, and every one of them basically benefit from this project. I would ask you to keep in mind this project just a little bit, because we're going to go back to it in a second. This is another traditional junior that has done a great model. So Turquoise Hill Resources, I'm sure many of you are familiar with it. So basically, although they listed at a very good price, then they had a very flat line, flat price for some time until they start pulling out some good drilling results. With that, you can see the share price has reflected very good. And then during the resource definition and resource increase, basically you had a very good price kept at above $5 level. But then when the project went into the permitting the exploration project to a mine, the share price crashed. And as you can see from the Pierre Lassonde, the graph here at the top right, and for which we talked a bit earlier, it is usually an area with a lot of speculations. As I said, some projects do not even make past this decrease in price, basically because there are a lot of uncertainties about this. But as you can see, Turquoise Hill very quickly basically permitted the project and developed it into a mine basically in a few years' time. So this is a typical successful traditional junior, but not many companies are able to do what the Turquoise Hill or what the Reservoir Minerals did. So if we look at Prospect Generator, so Altius Minerals is one of the best that has done it. Probably it can be considered like the base for all the prospect generators. So what Altius Minerals did, same. So they had very difficulties in the beginning, running at a very low share price, but they went after different metals. So they was looking for uranium, they was looking for iron, etc. So the way they basically make money and made money is by diversifying their portfolio. For example, they invested in a uranium project which they owned with Altius, about $600,000. And then they spun out that uranium project to a different company. And in 2 years, they sold the interest, the $600,000 interest, they sold it for $200 million. So it's one of the best success stories. So it is very interesting fact, by the way, that Aurora Energy, the company that they sold it, the project to, after two more years, they got sold entirely for $260 million. So basically, Altius Mineral made a lot of money by taking its interest or by cashing the interest in a good time. So similar to Aurora, they also have some good iron projects, which they spun out to another company, and they had the similar success. They haven't sold interest on this other company, Alderon Iron Ore Corp, but they have made the same progress. So basically, it's a similar success story. So once they put their money into different projects and there was cashing out from sale, basically then they start to buy, became a royalty company. And as you can see, basically the company have been doing very well from then. So this is one of the best project generators in the industry. This is another very successful project generator, is EMX Royalty Corp. Up until 2017, it used to be called Eurasian Minerals, but they become a royalty owner and generator basically, and then they changed their name to EMX Royalty Corp. And it is kind of similar to the Altius Minerals. Basically, they started to generate project for themselves and develop it a little bit further and then option to other groups. So you can see the share price reflection basically and understand the success they had. I told you about keeping in mind reservoir mineral just a little bit earlier, because EMX Royalty bit of connection with this success. So EMX Royalty used to own prospective ground around Çukarpeki, and before Reservoir Minerals came to acquire Çukarpeki, EMX then recognized it and bought some NSR in that project for 200,000 euros. They bought 0.5% NSR. So now that you can imagine, now the project is multi-billion dollars. So basically they got 0.5% NSR just for 200. Good. It used to be just a prospective ground, whilst now the resources of the project, not sure if you can all see the table, it has two type of, is the high sulfidation system, which is 28.7 million tons at 3.7% copper and 2.4 grams per ton gold. And then the lower part of the deposit, which is porphyry, which is 1.6 billion tons at 0.86% copper and 0.18 grams per ton gold. So basically, EMX has been very successful in recognizing the potential in the area. They bought the interest in the project very early, and now the project is a multi-billion dollar value. What is important here is that EMX is trading about 450 Canadian dollars right now, but it's having the same success as Altius basically. So if you can see EMX portfolio, they now own hundreds of deposits and mines, mostly through royalty, but also they've been, because they have a lot of cash on their hand, they've been able to do different alliances and strategic investments throughout the world, basically. So to kind of close things up a little bit, why we would choose a prospect generator instead of other type of companies, because the exploration is the riskiest stage in the development cycle of any project. Odds for discovery are very low. If we look stats, I've taken here the third paragraph, is basically from a PDAC convention last year, showing that out of 10,000 identified mineral prospects, only about 10% of them will lead to a drilling program. So 90% of them do not even have potential to be drilled. But only 0.01% will lead to a new mine. So as the project exploration, as a project generator, or as a traditional junior company, this is what you have to keep in mind, that only 0.01% of 10,000 identified mineral prospects will become a mine. So the odds are very, very low. But why we choose a project generator or a prospect generator is because instead of trying to spend years in one project or two, you're gonna be having the opportunity from multiple projects generated, basically. So we know now why it's important to own or to run a project generator, prospect generator. And this is basically why it is difficult to run, or what are the disadvantages of a prospect generator. So the most important one is share price depreciation. So as soon as you partner a prospect to a company, even though they're gonna spend millions in that project, basically you won't be benefiting from the development of the project. That won't really reflect into the share price, because in some cases, for example, you do deals with private companies and they do not release a lot of news. But even if they are public companies and they do release a lot of news, basically the share price doesn't really reflect that. I have taken 20 most known, at least for me, project generators listed on Toronto Stock Exchange or Canadian Venture Exchange. And as you can clearly see, out of 20 exploration companies, you only have three that have stand a bit more. And most of them basically show that no reflection on the share price. Although you see some companies that are in the business for 20, 25 years, they haven't been able to really run the model like EMX or like Altius. So it is a very difficult business either way, but by optioning your prospects to bigger groups and having different thoughts on projects, you always stand a better chance than probably trying to go all in one project or two. Thank you very much for listening, and I hope you have any question.
Thank you, Mater, a lot of this very interesting presentation. We do have a couple of questions here, but before going into those, I may present one question of my own. What kind of finance what type of finance you can raise if you list a generator company? What type of finance you are and deals you can do with the other partners? Could you a little bit give more lights on that aspect?
Yeah, you can do different financings basically. So usually you would finance like a minimum, let's say 200 to 500,000 euros to generate a prospect. And then if it has some legs, then you can basically find your best partner for that project. So usually is the most common is the earning type deals. So basically you bring partners to spend, let's say 1 million for 30%, another million for 50%. So it depends on the size and the prospectivity of the project, you can generate different investments. So I can talk a little bit. For example, I mentioned earlier Avrupa. They invested in this project in Kosovo about 200K, but their partner came in and invested 5 or 6 million in the project. So basically, if you read Avrupa's stats, they promote that for every dollar they have financed, they have put in the project $1.50, which is basically from money they have brought in from different partners.
Okay, thank you, Demi. Okay, then we have a couple of more questions here. And you said that this very low percentage of the prospective areas which actually lead to a mine. So what do you think is the main factor for that? Is it the lack of finance, or what do you think is the main factor why it is so low percentage?
There will always be finance for good projects. Thing is that you have in the world today a lot of anomalies, but they do not make an economic deposit. So basically, a prospect generator or guys who have some economic geology on their mind and basically try to generate prospects or projects that have potential to become mines. Most of the anomalies on Earth, they are not mine. But a lot of companies would even go after smaller prospects. And that's why basically we have this very low case of discoveries. As I said here, can you see my graph still? So if you look, the gold discoveries last 30 years, above 2 million ounces, you can see that from 2017, we do not have a single discovery of gold. So we have anomalies discovered, but in most cases, they do not become mines.
Okay, thank you. So then we have a long question, or actually, which is a statement saying that the prospect generator model can be used by national geological surveys, which have the state mandate to explore and identify high prospective areas. Upon locating the potential prospect, it can be sold to a mining company for detailed exploration, evaluation, eventual mining. In such case, what would be the reasonable royalty percentage for the National Geological Survey?
Well, I do not know if there are countries that basically would go into business, but I explained here in this slide that Kosovo, in order to attract investments, have covered entire country with airborne geophysics and stream sediment data. And basically, any company that is interested to come and work in Kosovo, they would sell the specific data that they are interested for the specific area. But a country to do that, that's a bit of a socialist kind of way of doing business. But if, I don't know from who was the question, but there is some sense to that question. So if Kosovo, for example, wants to run that kind of model, yes, it can cover entire prospectivity in Kosovo and then try to JV. But countries normally does that. So basically Kosovo has done that in order to be attractive for the exploration companies to come in. And then basically it's up to companies to come and explore into details.
We have one question which came via internet, and it states, as an investor, what are the suitable times to buy in and sell out when investing to the project generator. What are the signs to look for when playing on the stock exchange?
Yeah, so the only thing to look after basically is the management team, because it's not possible to probably know exactly at the potential of the prospect. But if you know that the management team of the company has done this before, has gone through exploration or multi-exploration in their experience, then basically you just believe that. Because, or for example, these companies we talked late in the presentation, for example, EMX owns 150 companies with different interests. So basically they do not need to even go raise money for buying other projects, because they have a lot of cash from the producing mines. So a company that has a management that can build something like Altius or EMX, basically you just go after people.
Okay, then we have a accumulation of questions here. So one is asking, can we apply this project generator model, business model, to all kind of minerals?
We can, but we usually have to see how the market is. Like if you want to look at lead zinc stuff, for example, today, because the pandemic and the mineral cycle, it won't be too impressive, but you can absolutely run, not in mining, you can also run in other industries.
Okay. So then there are people who are stating, not so much asking, but John Perry is stating that the hard for analysts to value prospect generator and hence maybe the underperforming share price. Being a prospect generator is essentially an organic royalty generator model, and royalties are a long-term investment plan.
Yes, most of the companies do not, most of the prospect generators do not have time to wait for the project to go to production and then start benefit. So most of the project generators would try to invest a couple of hundred thousands in a project and sell it for a million a few years later, take that million and go split it in five other projects. So they would, most would not wait and convert it to NSR unless they are a long experienced companies like Altius or EMX, who basically have converted themselves into a royalty generator company.
Okay, thank you. Then I may take one last question, saying that several of your examples are Canadian companies operating around the world. Is the model accepted by Europe, and are their European exchange specializing in providing finance for such prospector generator companies?
Yes, there are a lot of AIM listed companies, for example, from London, that runs this model as well. But I've taken Toronto Stock Exchange because it's like the main market for the mining companies. But yeah, a lot of these companies, by the way, are listed in London and Frankfurt as well. So yes, just that the Canadian mining market is a little bit bigger.
Okay. So we are accumulating more and more questions. I may still give an opportunity to two questions. One is, in which phase or project you would like to invest, or why?
Yeah. So usually you would try to invest a pre-discovery, so before the big announcement. So once the discovery is made, then the share price can reflect very, very, very good. But as I said earlier, because prospect generators would option their project to other groups to finance for discovering the project, usually you do not benefit as a prospect generator too much from the share price. So basically you just have to be patient. So first you have to choose the team that can really bring a couple of hundred thousand investments to multi-million investment in a return in a few years. So basically you just have to choose the people and not specific project.
Okay. I think that was the last question we answered by this time. I thank you all for listening this. I thank you, Mentor, for giving this presentation and all the people attending this. Good coming weekend and stay safe and in good health. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you very much, Andrew, and thank you very much, everyone.